Thankful Blossom by Bret Harte. Podcast 1 of 2. 1. The time was the year of grace 1779, the locality, Morristown, New Jersey. It was bitterly cold. A northeasterly wind had been stiffening the mud of the morning's thaw into a rigid record of that day's wayfaring on the Basking Ridge Road. The hoofprints of cavalry, the deep ruts left by baggage wagons, and the deeper channels worn by artillery, lay stark and cold in the waning light of an April day. There were icicles on the fences, a rime of silver on the windward bark of maples, and occasional bare spots on the rocky protuberances of the road, as if nature had worn herself out at the knees and elbows through long waiting for the tardy spring. A few leaves disinterred by the thaw became crisp again, and rustled in the wind, making the summer a thing so remote that all human hope and conjecture fled before them. Here and there the wayside fences and walls were broken down or dismantled, and beyond them fields of snow downtrodden and discolored, and strewn with fragments of leather, camp equipage, harness, and cast-off clothing, showed traces of the recent encampment and congregation of men. On some there were still standing the ruins of rudely constructed cabins, or the semblance of fortification equally rude and incomplete. A fox stealing along a half-filled ditch, a wolf slinking behind an earthwork, typified the human abandonment and desolation. One by one the faint sunset tints faded from the sky, the far-off crests of the orange hills grew darker, the nearer files of pines on the Whatnong Mountain became a mere black background, and, with the coming on of night, came to an icy silence that seemed to stiffen and arrest the very wind itself. The crisp leaves no longer rustled, the waving whips of alder and willow snapped no longer, the icicles no longer dropped a cold fruitage from barren branch and spray, and the roadside trees relapsed into stony quiet, so that the sound of horses' hoofs breaking through the thin, dull, lustreless films of ice that patched the furrowed road, might have been heard by the nearest continental picket a mile away. Either a knowledge of this, or the difficulties of the road, evidently irritated the viewless horseman. Long before he became visible, his voice was heard in half-suppressed objurgation of the road, of his beast, of the country folk, and the country generally. "Steady, you jade! Jump, you devil, jump! Curse the road, and the beggarly farmers that durst not mend it!" And then the moving bulk of horse and rider suddenly arose above the hill, floundered and splashed, and then as suddenly disappeared, and the rattling hoofbeats ceased. The stranger had turned into a deserted lane still cushioned with untrodden snow. A stone wall on one hand in better keeping and condition than the boundary monuments of the outlying fields bespoke protection and exclusiveness. Halfway up the lane the rider checked his speed, and, dismounting, tied his horse to a wayside sapling. This done, he went cautiously forward toward the end of the lane, and a farmhouse from whose gable window a light twinkled through the deepening night. Suddenly he stopped, hesitated, and uttered an impatient ejaculation. The light had disappeared. He turned sharply on his heel, and retraced his steps until opposite a farm shed that stood a few paces from the wall. Hard by, a large elm cast the gaunt shadow of its leafless limbs on the wall and surrounding snow. The stranger stepped into this shadow, and at once seemed to become a part of its trembling intricacies. At the present moment it was certainly a bleak place for a tryst. There was snow yet clinging to the trunk of the tree, and a film of ice on its bark, the adjacent wall was slippery with frost, and fringed with icicles. Yet in all there was a ludicrous suggestion of some sentiment past and unseasonable. Several dislodged stones of the wall were so disposed as to form a bench and seats, and under the elm tree's film of ice could still be seen carved on its bark the effigy of a heart, divers initials, and the legend, "Thine Forever." The stranger, however, kept his eyes fixed only on the farmshed and the open field beside it. 5 minutes passed in fruitless expectancy. 10 minutes. And then the rising moon slowly lifted herself over the black range of the orange hills, and looked at him, blushing a little, as if the appointment were her own. The face and figure thus illuminated were those of a strongly built, handsome man of 30, so soldierly in bearing that it needed not the buff epaulettes and facings to show his captain's rank in the Continental Army. Yet there was something in his facial expression that contradicted the manliness of his presence, an irritation and querulousness that were inconsistent with his size and strength. This fretfulness increased as the moments went by without sign or motion in the faintly lit field beyond, until, in peevish exasperation, he began to kick the nearer stones against the wall. Moow. The soldier started. Not that he was frightened, nor that he had failed to recognize in these prolonged syllables the deep-chested, half-drowsy low of a cow, but that it was so near him, evidently just beside the wall. If an object so bulky could have approached him so near without his knowledge, might not she? Muo-o. He drew nearer the wall cautiously. So, cushy. Muli. Come up, bossy, he said persuasively. Moo, but here the low unexpectedly broke down, and ended in a very human and rather musical little laugh. Thankful, exclaimed the soldier, echoing the laugh a trifle uneasily and affectedly as a hooded little head arose above the wall. Well, replied the figure, supporting a prettily rounded chin on her hands, as she laid her elbows complacently on the wall, well, what did you expect? Did you want me to stand here all night, while you skulked moonstruck under a tree? Or did you look for me to call you by name? Did you expect me to shout out, Captain Alan Brewster? Thankful, hush. Captain Alan Brewster of the Connecticut contingent, continued the girl, with an affected raising of a low, pathetic voice that was, however, inaudible beyond the tree. Captain Brewster, behold me your obliged and humble servant and sweetheart to command. Captain Brewster succeeded, after a slight skirmish at the wall, in possessing himself of the girl's hand, at which, although still struggling, she relented slightly. It isn't every lad that I'd low for, she said, with an affected pout, and there may be others that would not take it amiss, though there be fine ladies enough at the assembly halls at Morristown as might think it hoydenish. Nonsense, love, said the captain, who had by this time mounted the wall, and encircled the girl's waist with his arm. Nonsense, you startled me only. But, he added, suddenly taking her round chin in his hand, and turning her face toward the moon with an uneasy half-suspicion, why did you take that light from the window? What has happened? We had unexpected guests, sweetheart, said Thankful, the Count just arrived. That infernal Hessian. He stopped, and gazed questioningly into her face. The moon looked upon her at the same time, the face was as sweet, as placid, as truthful, as her own. Possibly these two inconstants understood each other. Nay, Alan, he is not a Hessian, but an exiled gentleman from abroad, a nobleman. There are no noblemen now, sniffed the trooper contemptuously. Congress has so decreed it. All men are born free and equal. But they are not, Alan, said Thankful, with a pretty trouble in her brows, even cows are not born equal. Is yon calf that was dropped last night by Brindle the equal of my red heifer whose mother come by herself in a ship from Surrey? Do they look equal? Titles are but breath, said Captain Brewster doggedly. There was an ominous pause. Nay, there is one nobleman left, said Thankful, and he is my own, my nature's nobleman. Captain Brewster did not reply. From certain arch gestures and wreathed smiles with which this forward young woman accompanied her statement, it would seem to be implied that the gentleman who stood before her was the nobleman alluded to. At least, he so accepted it, and embraced her closely, her arms and part of her mantle clinging around his neck. In this attitude they remained quiet for some moments, slightly rocking from side to side like a metronome, a movement, I fancy, peculiarly bucolic, pastoral, and idyllic, and as such, I wot, observed by Theocritus and Virgil. At these supreme moments weak woman usually keeps her wits about her much better than your superior reasoning masculine animal, and, while the gallant captain was losing himself upon her perfect lips, Miss Thankful distinctly heard the farm gate click, and otherwise noticed that the moon was getting high and obtrusive. She half released herself from the captain's arms, thoughtfully and tenderly but firmly. Tell me all about yourself, Alan dear, she said quietly, making room for him on the wall. All, everything. She turned upon him her beautiful eyes habitually earnest and even grave in expression, yet holding in their brave brown depths a sweet, childlike reliance and dependency, eyes with a certain tender, deprecating droop in the brown-fringed lids, and yet eyes that seemed to say to every man who looked upon them, I am truthful, be frank with me. Indeed, I am convinced there is not one of my impressible sex, who, looking in those pleading eyes, would not have perjured himself on the spot rather than have disappointed their fair owner. Captain Brewster's mouth resumed its old expression of discontent. Everything is growing worse, thankful, and the cause is lost. Congress does nothing, and Washington is not the man for the crisis. Instead of marching to Philadelphia, and forcing that wretched rabble of Hancock and Adams at the point of the bayonet, he writes letters. A dignified, formal old fool, interrupted Mistress Thankful indignantly, and look at his wife. Didn't Mistress Ford and Mistress Bailey, I, and the best blood of Morris County, go down to his excellencies in their finest bibs and tuckers, and didn't they find my lady in a pinafore doing chores? Vastly polite treatment, indeed. As if the whole world didn't know that the general was taken by surprise when my lady came riding up from Virginia with all those fine cavaliers, just to see what his excellency was doing at these assembly balls. And fine doings, I dare say. This is but idle gossip, Thankful, said Captain Brewster with the faintest appearance of self-consciousness, the assembly balls are conceived by the general to strengthen the confidence of the townsfolk, and mitigate the rigors of the winter encampment. I go there myself rarely, I have but little taste for junketing and gavotting, with my country in such need. No, Thankful. What we want is a leader, and the men of Connecticut feel it keenly. If I have been spoken of in that regard, added the captain with a slight inflation of his manly breast, it is because they know of my sacrifices, because as New England yeomen they know my devotion to the cause. They know of my suffering. The bright face that looked into his was suddenly afire with womanly sympathy, the pretty brow was knit, the sweet eyes overflowed with tenderness. Forgive me, Alan. I forgot perhaps, love perhaps, dearest, you are hungry now. No, not now, replied Captain Brewster, with gloomy stoicism, yet, he added, it is nearly a week since I have tasted meat. I brought a few things with me, continued the girl, with a certain hesitating timidity. She reached down, and produced a basket from the shadow of the wall. These chickens, she held up a pair of pullets the commander-in-chief himself could not buy, I kept them for my commander. And this pot of marmalade, which I know my Alan loves, is the same I put up last summer. I thought very tenderly you might like a piece of that bacon you liked so once, dear. Ah, sweetheart, shall we ever sit down to our little board? Shall we ever see the end of this awful war? Don't you think, dear, very pleadingly, it would be best to give it up? King George is not such a very bad man, is he? I've thought, sweetheart, very confidently, that mayhap you and he might make it all up without the aid of those Washingtons, who do nothing but starve one to death. And if the king only knew you, Alan should see you as I do, sweetheart, he'd do just as you say. During this speech she handed him the several articles alluded to, and he received them, storing them away in such receptacles of his clothing as were convenient, with this notable difference, that with her the act was graceful and picturesque, with him there was a ludicrousness of suggestion that his broad shoulders and uniform only heightened. I think not of myself, lass, he said, putting the eggs in his pocket, and buttoning the chickens within his martial breast. I think not of myself, and perhaps I often spare that counsel which is but little heeded. But I have a duty to my men, to Connecticut. He here tied the marmalade up in his handkerchief. I confess I have sometimes thought I might, under provocation, be driven to extreme measures for the good of the cause. I make no pretense to leadership, but with you at the head of the army, broke in Thankful enthusiastically, peace would be declared within a fortnight. There is no flattery, however outrageous, that a man will not accept from the woman whom he believes loves him. he will perhaps doubt its influence in the colder judgment of mankind, but he will consider that this poor creature, at least, understands him, and in some vague way represents the eternal but unrecognized verities. And when this is voiced by lips that are young and warm and red, it is somehow quite as convincing as the bloodless, remoter utterance of posterity. Wherefore the trooper complacently buttoned the compliment over his chest with the pullets. "I think you must go now, Alan," she said, looking at him with that pseudo-maternal air which the youngest of women sometimes assume to their lovers, as if the doll had suddenly changed sex, and grown to man's estate. "You must go now, dear, for it may so chance that father is considering my absence overmuch. You will come again a Wednesday, sweetheart, and you will not go to the assemblies, nor visit Mistress Judith, nor take any girl Pique back again on your black horse, and you will let me know when you are hungry." She turned her brown eyes lovingly, yet with a certain pretty trouble in the brow, and such a searching, pleading inquiry in her glance, that the captain kissed her at once. Then came the final embrace, performed by the captain in a half-perfunctory, quiet manner, with a due regard for the friable nature of part of his provisions. Satisfying himself of the integrity of the eggs by feeling for them in his pocket, he waved a military salute with the other hand to Miss Thankful, and was gone. A few minutes later the sound of his horse's hoofs rang sharply from the icy hillside. But, as he reached the summit, two horsemen wheeled suddenly from the shadow of the roadside, and bade him halt. "Captain Brewster, if this moon does not deceive me," queried the foremost stranger with grave civility. "The same. Major Van Zandt, I calculate," returned Brewster querulously. "Your calculation is quite right. I regret, Captain Brewster, that it is my duty to inform you that you are under arrest." "By whose orders?" "The Commander-in-Chief's." "For what?" "Mutinous conduct, and disrespect of your superior officers." The sword that Captain Brewster had drawn at the sudden appearance of the strangers quivered for a moment in his strong hand. Then, sharply striking it across the pommel of his saddle, he snapped it in twain, and cast the pieces at the feet of the speaker. "Go on," he said doggedly. "Captain Brewster," said Major Van Zandt, with infinite gravity, "it is not for me to point out the danger to you of this outspoken emotion, except practically in its effect upon the rations you have in your pocket. If I mistake not, they have suffered equally with your steel. Forward, march." Captain Brewster looked down, and then dropped to the rear, as the disc-assed yokes of Mistress Thankful's most precious gift slid slowly and pensively over his horse's flanks to the ground. 2. Mistress Thankful remained at the wall until her lover had disappeared. Then she turned, a mere lissom shadow in that uncertain light, and glided under the eaves of the shed, and thence from tree to tree of the orchard, lingering a moment under each as a trout lingers in the shadow of the bank in passing a shallow, and so reached the farmhouse and the kitchen door, where she entered. Thence by a back staircase she slipped to her own bower, from whose window half an hour before she had taken the signaling light. This she lit again and placed upon a chest of drawers, and, taking off her hood and a shapeless sleeveless mantle she had worn, went to the mirror, and proceeded to readjust a high horn comb that had been somewhat displaced by the captain's arm, and otherwise after the fashion of her sex to remove all traces of a previous lover. It may be here observed that a man is very apt to come from the smallest encounter with his Dulcinea dist irate, bored, or shamefaced, to forget that his cravat is awry, or that a long blonde hair is adhering to his button. But as to Mademoiselle, well, looking at Miss Pussy's sleek paws and spotless face, would you ever know that she had been at the cream jug? Thankful was, I think, satisfied with her appearance. Small doubt but she had reason for it. And yet her gown was a mere slip of flowered chintz, gathered at the neck, and falling at an angle of 15 degrees to within an inch of a short petticoat of grey flannel. But so surely is the complete mold of symmetry indicated in the poise or line of any single member, that looking at the erect carriage of her graceful brown head, or below to the curves that were lost in her shapely ankles, or the little feet that hid themselves in the broad-buckled shoes, you knew that the rest was as genuine and beautiful. Mistress Thankful, after a pause, opened the door, and listened. Then she softly slipped down the back staircase to the front hall. It was dark, but the door of the company room, or parlor, was faintly indicated by the light that streamed beneath it. She stood still for a moment hesitatingly, when suddenly a hand grasped her own, and half-led, half-dragged her, into the sitting room opposite. It was dark. There was a momentary fumbling for the tinderbox and flint, a muttered oath over one or two impeding articles of furniture, and Thankful left. And then the light was lit, and her father, a gray wrinkled man of 60, still holding her hand, stood before her. "You have been out, mistress."
"I have," said Thankful.
"And not alone," growled the old man angrily.
"No," said Mistress Thankful, with a smile that began in the corners of her brown eyes, ran down into the dimpled curves of her mouth, and finally ended in the sudden revelation of her white teeth. "No, not alone."
"With whom?" asked the old man, gradually weakening under her strong, saucy presence.
"Well, father," said Thankful, taking a seat on a table, and swinging her little feet somewhat ostentatiously toward him, "I was with Captain Alan Brewster of the Connecticut contingent."
That man.
"I forbid you seeing him again."
Thankful gripped the table with a hand on each side of her, to emphasize the statement, and swinging her feet replied,
"I shall see him as often as I like, father."
"Thankful Blossom.
Abner Blossom.
I see you know not," said Mr. Blossom, abandoning the severely paternal mandatory air for one of confidential disclosure, "I see you know not his reputation. He is accused of inciting his regiment to revolt, of being a traitor to the cause."
"And since when, Abner Blossom, have you felt such concern for the cause?"
"Since you refused to sell supplies to the Continental Commissary, except at double profits?
Since you told me you were glad I had not polities like Mistress Ford."
"Hush," said the father, motioning to the parlor.
"Hush," echoed Thankful indignantly.
"I won't be hushed. Everybody says hush to me.
The Count says hush.
Alan says hush.
You say hush.
I'm a weary of this hushing.
Ah, if there was a man who didn't say it to me," and Mistress Thankful lifted her fine eyes to the ceiling.
"You are unwise, Thankful foolish, indiscreet.
That is why you require much monition."
Thankful swung her feet in silence for a few moments, then suddenly leaped from the table, and, seizing the old man by the lapels of his coat, fixed her eyes upon him, and said suspiciously,
"Why did you keep me from going in the company room? Why did you bring me in here?"
Blossom Senior was staggered for a moment.
"Because, you know, the Count.
And you were afraid the Count should know I had a sweetheart?"
"Well, I'll go in and tell him now," she said, marching toward the door.
"Then, why did you not tell him when you slipped out an hour ago,
eh, lass?" queried the old man, grasping her hand.
"But 'tis all one, Thankful, 'twas not for him I stopped you. There is a young spark with him. I came even as you left, lass, a likely young gallant, and he and the Count are jabbering away in their own lingo, a kind of Italian, belike, eh, Thankful."
"I know not," she said thoughtfully, "which way came the other."
In fact, a fear that this young stranger might have witnessed the captain's embrace began to creep over her.
"From town, my lass."
Thankful turned to her father as if she had been waiting a reply to a long-asked question.
"Well, were it not well to put on a few furbelows and a tucker?" queried the old man.
"'Tis a gallant young spark, none of your country folk."
"No," said Thankful, with the promptness of a woman who was looking her best, and knew it.
And the old man, looking at her, accepted her judgment, and without another word led her to the parlor door, and, opening it, said briefly, "My daughter, Mistress Thankful Blossom." With the opening of the door came the sound of earnest voices that instantly ceased upon the appearance of Mistress Thankful. Two gentlemen lolling before the fire arose instantly,
and one came forward with an air of familiar yet respectful recognition.
"Nay, this is far too great happiness, Mistress Thankful," he said, with a strongly marked foreign accent, and a still more strongly marked foreign manner. "I have been in despair, and my friend here, the Baron Pompasso, likewise." The slightest trace of a smile, and the swiftest of reproachful glances, lit up the dark face of the Baron as he bowed low in the introduction. Thankful dropped the courtesy of the period, i.e., a duck, with semicircular sweep of the right foot forward. But the right foot was so pretty, and the grace of the little figure so perfect, that the Baron raised his eyes from the foot to the face in serious admiration. In the one rapid feminine glance she had given him, she had seen that he was handsome; in the second, which she could not help from his protracted silence, she saw that his beauty centered in his girlish, half fawn-like dark eyes. "The Baron," explained Mr. Blossom, rubbing his hands together as if through mere friction he was trying to impart a warmth to the reception which his hard face discountenanced, "the Baron visits us under discouragement. He comes from far countries. It is the custom of gentlefolk of a foreign extraction to wander through strange lands, commenting upon the habits and doings of the peoples. He will find in Jersey," continued Mr. Blossom, apparently appealing to Thankful, yet really evading her contemptuous glance, "a hard-working yeomanry, ever ready to welcome the stranger, and account to him, penny for penny, for all his necessary expenditure, for which purpose, in these true blues times, he will provide for himself gold or other monies not affected by these local disturbances. He will find, good friend Blossom," said the Baron in a rapid, voluble way, utterly at variance with the soft, quiet gravity of his eyes, "beauty, grace, accomplishment, and Santa Maria, what shall I say?" He turned appealingly to the Count.
"Virtue," nodded the Count.
"Truly, virtue, all in the fair lady of these countries. Ah, believe me, honest friend Blossom, there is much more in these than in thus." So much of this speech was addressed to Mistress Thankful, that she had to show at least one dimple in reply, albeit her brows were slightly knit, and she had turned upon the speaker her honest, questioning eyes. "And then the General Washington has been kind enough to offer his protection," added the Count. "Any fool, anyone," supplemented Thankful hastily, with a slight blush, "may have the General's pass, aye, and his good word. But what of Mistress Prudence Bookstaver, she that has a sweetheart in Nifazen's brigade? I warrant a Hessian, but of gentle blood, as Mistress Prudence has often told me, and, look you, all her letters stopped by the General, I warrant, read by my Lady Washington too, as if 'twere her fault that her lad was in arms against Congress. Riddle me that, now." "'Tis but Prudence, lass," said Blossom, frowning on the girl. "'Tis that she might disclose some movement of the army, tending to defeat the enemy. And why should she not try to save her lad from capture or ambuscade such as befell the Hessian commissary with the provisions that you—" Mr. Blossom, in an ostensible fatherly embrace, managed to pinch Mistress Thankful sharply.
"Hush, lass," he said with simulated playfulness, "your tongue clacks like the whippany mill. My daughter has small concern, 'tis the manner of women folk in politics," he explained to his guests. "These dangersome days have given her sore affliction by way of parting comrades of her childhood, and others whom she has much affected. It has in some sort soured her." Mr. Blossom would have recalled this speech as soon as it escaped him, lest it should lead to a revelation from the truthful Mistress Thankful of her relations with the Continental captain. But to his astonishment, and, I may add, to my own, she showed nothing of that disposition she had exhibited a few moments before. On the contrary, she blushed slightly, and said nothing. And then the conversation changed upon the weather, the hard winter, the prospects of the cause, a criticism upon the Commander-in-Chief's management of affairs, the attitude of Congress, etc., between Mr. Blossom and the Count, characterized, I hardly need say, by that positiveness of opinion that distinguishes the unprofessional. In another part of the room, it so chanced that Mistress Thankful and the Baron were talking about themselves, the assembly balls, who was the prettiest woman in Morristown, and whether Jen Washington's attentions to Mistress Pine were only perfunctory gallantry, or what, and if Lady Washington's hair was really gray, and if that young aide-de-camp, Major Van Zandt, were really in love with Lady, or whether his attentions were only the zeal of a subaltern, in the midst of which a sudden gust of wind shook the house, and Mr. Blossom, going to the front door, came back with the announcement that it was snowing heavily. And indeed, within that past hour, to their astonished eyes the whole face of nature had changed. The moon was gone, the sky hidden in a blinding, whirling swarm of stinging flakes. The wind, bitter and strong, had already fashioned white feathery drifts upon the threshold, over the painted benches on the porch, and against the doorposts. Mistress Thankful and the Baron had walked to the rear door, the Baron with a slight tropical shudder to view this meteorological change. As Mistress Thankful looked over the snowy landscape, it seemed to her that all record of her past experience had been effaced, her very footprints of an hour before were lost, the grey wall on which she leaned was white and spotless now, even the familiar farmshed looked dim and strange and ghostly. Had she been there? Had she seen the captain? Was it all a fancy? She scarcely knew. A sudden gust of wind closed the door behind them with a crash, and sent Mistress Thankful, with a slight feminine scream, forward into the outer darkness. But the Baron caught her by the waist, and saved her from heaven knows what imaginable disaster, and the scene ended in a half-hysterical laugh. But the wind then set upon them both with a malevolent fury, and the Baron was, I presume, obliged to draw her closer to his side. They were alone, save for the presence of those mischievous confederates, Nature and Opportunity. In the half-obscurity of the storm she could not help turning her mischievous eyes on his. But she was perhaps surprised to find them luminous, soft, and, as it seemed to her at that moment, grave beyond the occasion. An embarrassment utterly new and singular seized upon her, and when, as she half feared yet half expected, he bent down and pressed his lips to hers, she was for a moment powerless. But in the next instant she boxed his ears sharply, and vanished in the darkness. When Mr. Blossom opened the door to the Baron, he was surprised to find that gentleman alone, and still more surprised to find, when they re-entered the house, to see Mistress Thankful enter at the same moment, demurely, from the front door. When Mr. Blossom knocked at his daughter's door the next morning, it opened upon her completely dressed, but withal somewhat pale, and, if the truth must be told, a little surly. And you were stirring so early, Thankful, he said, 'twould have been but decent to have bidden Godspeed to the guests, especially the Baron, who seemed much concerned at your absence. Miss Thankful blushed slightly, but answered with savage seal righty, and since when is it necessary that I should dance attendance upon every foreign jack in the box that may lie at the house? He has shown great courtesy to you, mistress, and is a gentleman. Courtesy, indeed, said Mistress Thankful. He has not presumed, said Mr. Blossom suddenly, bringing his cold grey eyes to bear upon his daughters. No, no, said Thankful hurriedly, flaming a bright scarlet, but nothing. But what have you there? A letter. I from the captain, I warrant, said Mr. Blossom, handing her a three-cornered bit of paper, 'twas left here by a camp follower. Thankful, he continued, with a meaning glance, you will heed my counsel in season. The captain is not meet for such as you. Thankful suddenly grew pale and contemptuous again as she snatched the letter from his hand. When his retiring footsteps were lost on the stairs, she regained her color, and opened the letter. It was slovenly written, grievously misspelled, and read as follows. Sweetheart, a tyrannous act, begotten in envy and jealousy, keeps me here a prisoner. Last night I was basely arrested by servile hands for that freedom of thought and expression for which I have already sacrificed so much. I all that man hath but love and honor. But the end is near. When for the maintenance of power, the liberties of the peoples are subdued by martial supremacy and the dictates of ambition, the state is lost. I lie in vile bondage here in Morristown under charge of disrespect me that a 12-month past left a home and respectable connections to serve my country. believe me still your own love, albeit in the power of tyrants and condemned it may be to the scaffold. The messenger is trustworthy and will speed safely to me such as you may deliver unto him. The provender sanctified by your hands and made precious by year. Love was wrested from me by servile hands and the eggs, sweetheart, were somewhat addled. The bacon is, methinks by this time on the table of the comrade-in-chief. Such is tyranny and ambition. Sweetheart, farewell, for the present. Alan. Mistress Thankful read this composition once, twice, and then tore it up. Then, reflecting that it was the first letter of her lover's that she had not kept, she tried to put together again the torn fragments, but vainly, and then in a pet, new to her, cast them from the window. During the rest of the day she was considerably distraught, and even manifested more temper than she was wont to do, and later, when her father rode away on his daily visit to Morristown, she felt strangely relieved. By noon the snow ceased, or rather turned into a driving sleet that again in turn gave way to rain. By this time she became absorbed in her household duties in which she was usually skillful and in her own thoughts that today had a novelty in their meaning. In the midst of this, at about dark, her room being in the rear of the house, she was perhaps unmindful of the trampling of horse without, or the sound of voices in the hall below. Neither was uncommon at that time. Although protected by the Continental Army from forage or the rudeness of soldiery, the Blossom Farm had always been a halting place for passing troopers, commissary teamsters, and reconnoitering officers. Jen. Sullivan and Col. Hamilton had watered their horses at its broad, substantial wayside trough, and sat in the shade of its porch. Miss Thankful was only awakened from her daydream by the entrance of the Negro farmhand, Caesar. F.O. God, Missy Thankful, them sogers is g-wine into camp in the road, I reckon, for they's just makin' theyselves free A.F.O. the house, and they's an officer in the company room with his spurs cocked on the table, readin' a book. A quick flame leaped into Thankful's cheek, and her pretty brows knit themselves over darkening eyes. She arose from her work no longer the moody girl, but an indignant goddess, and, pushing the servant aside, swept down the stairs, and threw open the door. An officer sitting by the fire in an easy, lounging attitude that justified the servant's criticism, arose instantly with an air of evident embarrassment and surprise that was, however, as quickly dominated and controlled by a gentleman's breeding. "I beg your pardon," he said, with a deep inclination of his handsome head, "but I had no idea that there was any member of this household at home, at least, a lady." He hesitated a moment, catching in the raising of her brown-fringed lids a sudden revelation of her beauty, and partly losing his composure. "I am Major Van Zant, I have the honor of addressing." "Thankful Blossom," said Thankful a little proudly, divining with a woman's swift instinct the cause of the major's hesitation. But her triumph was checked by a new embarrassment visible in the face of the officer at the mention of her name. "Thankful Blossom," repeated the officer quickly. "You are, then, the daughter of Abner Blossom?" "Certainly," said Thankful, turning her inquiring eyes upon him. "He will be here betimes. He has gone only to Morristown." In a new fear that had taken possession of her, her questioning eyes asked, "Has he not?" The officer, answering her eyes rather than her lips, came toward her gravely. "He will not return today, Mistress Thankful, nor perhaps even tomorrow. He is a prisoner." Thankful opened her brown eyes aggressively on the major. "A prisoner for what?" "For aiding and giving comfort to the enemy, and for harboring spies," replied the major with military curtness. Mistress Thankful's cheek flushed slightly at the last sentence. A recollection of the scene on the porch and the baron's stolen kiss flashed across her, and for a moment she looked as guilty as if the man before her had been a witness to the deed. He saw it, and misinterpreted her confusion. "Belike, then," said Mistress Thankful, slightly raising her voice, and standing squarely before the major, "belike, then, I should be a prisoner too, for the guests of this house, if they be spies, were my guests, and, as my father's daughter, I was their hostess, I, man, and right glad to be the hostess of such gallant gentlemen, I warrant, too fine to insult a defenseless girl, gentlemen spies that did not cock their boots on the table, or turn an honest farmer's house into a tap room. An expression of half pain, half amusement, covered the face of the major, but he made no other reply than by a profound and graceful bow. Courteous and deprecatory as it was, it apparently exasperated Mistress Thankful only the more. "And pray who are these spies, and who is the informer?" said Mistress Thankful, facing the soldier, with one hand truculently placed on her flexible hip, and the other slipped behind her. "Methinks 'tis only honest we should know when and how we have entertained both. Your father, Mistress Thankful," said Major Van Zant gravely, "has long been suspected of favoring the enemy, but it has been the policy of the Commander-in-Chief to overlook the political preferences of non-combatants, and to strive to win their allegiance to the good cause by liberal privileges. But when it was lately discovered that two strangers, although bearing a pass from him, have been frequenters of this house under fictitious names." "You mean Count Ferdinand and the Baron Pompasso," said Thankful quickly, "two honest gentlefolk, and if they choose to pay their devoirs to a lass, although, perhaps, not a quality lady, yet an honest girl." "Dear Mistress Thankful," said the major with a profound bow and smile, that, spite of its courtesy, drove Thankful to the verge of wrathful hysterics, "if you establish that fact and, from this slight acquaintance with your charms, I doubt not you will your father is safe from further inquiry or detention. The Commander-in-Chief is a gentleman who has never underrated the influence of your sex, nor held himself averse to its fascinations." "What is the name of this informer?" broke in Mistress Thankful angrily. "Who is it that has dared?" "It is but king's evidence, mayhap, Mistress Thankful, for the informer is himself under arrest. It is on the information of Captain Alan Brewster of the Connecticut contingent." Mistress Thankful whitened, then flushed, and then whitened again. Then she stood up to the major. "It's a lie, a cowardly lie." Major Van Zant bowed. Mistress Thankful flew upstairs, and in another moment swept back again into the room in riding hat and habit. "I suppose I can go and see my father," she said, without lifting her eyes to the officer. "You are free as air, Mistress Thankful. My orders and instructions, far from implicating you in your father's offenses, do not even suggest your existence. Let me help you to your horse." The girl did not reply. During that brief interval, however, Caesar had saddled her white mare, and brought it to the door. Mistress Thankful, disdaining the offered hand of the major, sprang to the saddle. The major still held the reins. "One moment, Mistress Thankful. Let me go," she said, with suppressed passion. "One moment, I beg." His hand still held her bridle rein. The mare reared, nearly upsetting her. Crimson with rage and mortification, she raised her riding whip, and laid it smartly over the face of the man before her. He dropped the rein instantly. Then he raised to her a face calm and colorless, but for a red line extending from his eyebrow to his chin, and said quietly, "I had no desire to detain you. I only wished to say that when you see Gen. Washington, I know you will be just enough to tell him that Major Van Zant knew nothing of your wrongs, or even your presence here, until you presented them, and that since then he has treated you as became an officer and a gentleman." Yet even as he spoke she was gone. At the moment that her fluttering skirt swept in a furious gallop down the hillside, the major turned, and re-entered the house. The few lounging troopers who were witnesses of the scene prudently turned their eyes from the white face and blazing eyes of their officer as he strode by them. Nevertheless, when the door closed behind him, contemporary criticism broke out. "'Tis a Tory jade, vexed that she cannot befool the major as she has the captain," muttered Sergeant Tibbetts. "And going to try her tricks on the general," added Private Hicks. Howbeit both these critics may have been wrong. For as Mistress Thankful thundered down the Morristown Road she thought of many things. She thought of her sweetheart Alan, a prisoner, and pining for her help and her solicitude, and yet how dared he if he had really betrayed or misjudged her? And then she thought bitterly of the Count and the Baron, and burned to face the latter, and in some vague way charge the stolen kiss upon him as the cause of all her shame and mortification. And lastly she thought of her father, and began to hate everybody. But above all and through all, in her vague fears for her father, in her passionate indignation against the Baron, in her fretful impatience of Alan, one thing was ever dominant and obtrusive, one thing she tried to put away, but could not: the handsome, colorless face of Major Van Zandt, with the red welt of her riding whip overlying its cold outlines.